Now let's talk about interconnection networks used for message passing systems. In the early days, a lot of designs used a hypercube topology, which is something that looks like this. Now this particular diagram shows a cube that has three dimensions, that is, that has 2^3 nodes, or 8 nodes, and look at, for example, node 000. It's connected to 001, 010, and 100. And in general, it's connected to as many nodes as it has dimensions. There's three dimensions in this cube, so there are three nodes that each node is connected to. It's connected to the nodes whose numbers differ from it in exactly one bit. Well, the problem with a design like this is that if you get a lot of them, you have to have wires running from each node to the nodes that it directly connects to. If you just try to lay out a cube that's got three dimensions, it's not too much of a problem. You can configure the nodes so that the wires can get to where they need to be without going through very circuitous paths. But if you get up to 8 or 10 dimensions, you have a lot of area being used for wires just to connect the nodes. So, because of that, 2D meshes eventually supplanted hypercubes beginning about 1990. Here's an example of a 16-node mesh. Now, I want to draw your attention to the fact that we have interconnections in both the horizontal and vertical dimensions. In the vertical dimension, there are four cycles of nodes here because four is 16, which is the number of nodes. The square root of 16 is 4. So each node here is connected to the corresponding node that's above it. So node 12, for example, is connected to node 1. The A is connected to A, B is connected to C, B, C is connected to C, and D to D. That gives us four cycles of four nodes each in the vertical dimension. In the horizontal dimension, we have node 3 being connected to node 4. So the connections are not directly around the same row, but rather onto the next row, and the connection from the last row is around to the beginning. So that gives us a single cycle in the horizontal dimension. If we had the last element in each row directly connected to the first element in the same row, we'd have a torus instead. But one advantage of a mesh called an iliac 4 mesh, based upon the fact that this was the mesh used in the first mesh-based computer built back in the 1970s, a difference between this kind of mesh and the torus I talked about a second ago is that the average distance between nodes is slightly less if you have all nodes connected in one loop in one of the dimensions. It's not too hard to show that by working out some calculations for meshes of 4, 8, 16, and so forth, but we won't bother to do it right now. Now, another difference between early systems and current systems is that early systems used a FIFO in each link. If you look back up here, you'll see that there are FIFOs in between each two adjacent nodes. So for example, 001 is connected to node 101 by a FIFO. That means that node 001 can buffer messages that are destined for node 101. And each time a message is forwarded from one node to another, it gets buffered in a FIFO before it's finally delivered to the destination. That means that software sends had to be implemented as synchronous hardware operations on each node. Now, the problem for multi-hop messages was that every time you make a hop, you basically need to send the message through all the intermediate nodes. So all the intermediate nodes need to notice that the message is coming across and do a context switch to pass the message. Well, later on, synchronous operations were replaced by DMA, which enabled non-blocking transfers to occur. A DMA device is a special purpose controller that transfers data from memory in an I/O device without involving the processor. It's a little engine that goes along with the processor, so the processor can be working on, say, on one thread while the DMA is doing a transfer into memory. And this allows messages to be buffered by the message layer at the system and the destination until the receive takes place, and only then is the data copied into the address space of the receiving process. So this meant that the other nodes that were on the way from the source to the destination could continue to do their processing while messages were being passed, and that simplified things completely and made it a lot faster to pass messages. As a result, parallel algorithms no longer need to be changed to conform to the topology of the machine as often as they used to be. And in addition, we now have what's known as wormhole routing, where a message does not have to be buffered in between nodes, but rather the path is set up when the transfer begins, and then all packets of the message traverse the same path, and they do so without the need to calculate a new path from source to destination. So transfer of the message is essentially automatic with respect to the point of view of the nodes that it's passing through. That's much quicker, and it means that messages can be transmitted much more quickly and therefore much more frequently. In addition, there's a big difference today between the architectures of now and the architectures of 20 years ago. 20 years ago, there was a clear distinction between a message passing machine and a shared memory machine. You used the shared memory paradigm on a shared memory machine and the message passing paradigm on a message passing machine. But now, almost all message passing machines support some kind of shared virtual memory in software. It's not going to be as fast as it is if you have hardware shared memory, but you can do shared memory programming on a distributed memory machine. These systems share pages, for example, between processors. So if a page that's located in processor 3 is referenced by processor 5, then the operating system figures it out and goes and fetches the page from processor 3 and moves it over to node 5. Now that takes a considerable amount of time, and not all algorithms are going to work this way. Some of them are just going to become way too slow if you use pages that are being transferred basically by software. But some algorithms will work okay. So you can, in principle, use both kinds of programming on both kinds of architectures. Block diagrams for shared memory and message passing machines look basically the same. For each of them, you have a node consisting of a processor, a cache, and a memory controller, and that processor is connected to a network, be it a crossbar switch, a multi-stage network, or a bus. So the block diagrams look pretty much the same. Now, if you're writing programs for a shared address space model, a lot of times it's easier to write the program initially because you just have to put locks at the appropriate places in the data and then figure out which processes are going to do what. However, with message passing, you have to change your code to involve message send. For one process needs to send a message to another process, and then the other process needs to receive it, and that might require transforming the structure of the algorithm. So it's easier to get started with shared memory programming. But if you try to tune up your programs, you'll find that shared memory programs are still to some extent sensitive to where the data is. So you need to change your structure of your program or where the processes are allocated to make sure that they're close to the data. So in the long run, it doesn't make too much difference in terms of programming effort which of the models you use.